Hi, my name is Carlos Sr. I'm the lead pastor here at New Hope St. Pete. And this is my wife, Chantel.
Welcome to our online worship service.
While we're not gathered in the same space, we are held together in Christ.
We are so excited for this chance to worship with you.
We are grateful for your presence and hope that this service is a blessing to you and your family. If this is your first time with us, we'd like to thank you for joining us today.
We thank you for your prayers, your support, and your love for us and this church.
God loves you, and so do we. Now, let's ask God to bless our time together in worship.
Today's scripture is taken from Isaiah chapter 1, beginning at verse 5. Why do you continue to invite punishment? Must you rebel forever? Your head is injured, and your heart is sick. You are battered from head to foot, covered with bruises, welts, and infected wounds, without any soothing ointments or bandages. Your country lies in ruins, and your towns are burned. Foreigners plunder your fields before your eyes and destroy everything they see. Beautiful Jerusalem stands abandoned, like a watchman's shelter in a vineyard, like a lean-to in a cucumber field after the harvest, like a helpless city under siege. If the Lord of Heaven's armies had not spared a few of us, we would have been wiped out like Sodom, destroyed like Gomorrah. Listen to the Lord, you leaders of Sodom. Listen to the law of our God, people of Gomorrah. What makes you think I want all your sacrifices, says the Lord? I am sick of your burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened cattle. I get no pleasure from the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to worship me, who asked you to parade through my courts with all your ceremony? Stop bringing me your meaningless gifts. The incense of your offerings disgust me. As for your celebrations of the new moon and the Sabbath, and your special days for fasting, they are all sinful and false. I want no more of your pious meetings. I hate your new moon celebrations and your annual festivals. They are a burden to me. I cannot stand them. When you lift up your hands in prayer, I will not look. Though you offer many prayers, I will not listen. For your hands are covered with the blood of innocent victims. Wash yourselves and be clean. Get your sins out of my sight. Give up your evil ways. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Help the oppressed. Defend the cause of orphans. Fight for the rights of widows. Come now. Let's settle this, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, I will make them white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, I will make them white as wool. If you will only obey me, you will have plenty to eat. But if you turn away and refuse to listen, you will be devoured by the sword of your enemies. I, the Lord, have spoken. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We call on the name of Jesus, that name that is above every name, that at the sound of that name, the name of Jesus, at the sound of that name, the name of Jesus, just say it with me, Jesus, 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 at the sound of that name, Jesus, Jesus, things happen. Jesus, yokes are broken. Jesus, bodies are healed. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We bless you this morning, oh God. We give you glory, praise, and honor. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, We humbly bow before you, O God, and seek your face, O God, for our time of worship and our time of praise and our time of being in your word, O God. Father, anoint us right now, Father, to prepare our hearts and our minds and our bodies and our spirit, O God, to hear from you this morning, Lord God, for you have a word for us this morning, O God. And so we humbly submit ourselves to your sovereignty, O God. We yield to your spirit, O God, and say, Holy Spirit, have your way today, O God. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Speak to us. Minister us. Dry the tears, O God. Lift up countenance, O God. Make your face, O Lord, to shine upon us. God, we thank you for our time of coming together. We thank you, O God, for your presence. We thank you, O God, that you're already working in us, O God, to do and to will for your good pleasure. We love you, O God. We lift you up and magnify you. Oh God, we lift up this prayer unto you, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Father, for every person, oh God, that may not be feeling well, Father, I pray your healing be upon them in the name of Jesus. For everyone, Lord God, that is in need, Lord God, whatever that need is, Father, we're praying right now that you would meet that need, oh God, as we enter into our time of worship. Oh God, let them come into worship one way, but leave out another way, because your spirit, oh God, will have moved on them in the name of Jesus. So we're praying that the power of the Holy Ghost fall fresh upon each and every one of us right now. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall fresh upon each and every one of us right now. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall fresh upon each and every one of us right now as we enter into our time of worship and praise. This is our prayer unto you, O God, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Be glorified, O God, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen. Love and blessings to you always.
Good morning, and again, thank you to all of our partners who continue to support the work of ministry. That work here is an ongoing work. Your generous giving has allowed us to continue to sustain such ministries as our Bread Basket, Hope Closet. As we continue to meet needs and heal hurts in the surrounding community, we anticipate our continuing to partner together to meet those needs and to heal those hurts. We thank God for you and, again, your contributions. Amen.
Hello, New Hope. To all of our friends and guests, Pastor Senior here, excited to worship with you again today and to share in the word of the Lord. 2020 has stretched our faith in unimaginable ways. Death, disease, poverty, violence, fueled by fear, anger, ego, and greed. You know, none of these things are new issues, but 2020 has been like a clarifying shampoo, right? It has detoxed us of our assumptions and our superficialities. It has left us to really contemplate what is real and what is important. And so as Chantel and I have been having conversations about how our family wants to celebrate Christmas this year, especially in light of everything that has happened in 2020, there were some clarifying thoughts that came to mind. And I'd like to spend the next couple of weeks sharing those reflections with you. And maybe this word that God has shared with me and my family has been such a blessing to us that maybe it might also be a blessing to you. And so Christmas, in light of 2020, one of the things that our family will be reflecting on is how we need God close, right? Emmanuel, God is with us. We need God close. The God that I brought with me into 2020 wasn't close enough. He was too distant. Maybe the God that you brought with you into 2020 wasn't close enough. I need him close as I thought I was prior to the year. I recognized in this year that I need him closer. I've needed him closer still. And maybe there are others who are tuned in this morning where so much of what has come out of 2020 for you is the recognition of how much you need God and how close you need for him to be. Why? Because the darkness in the world is real, right? The darkness in the world is real. And that's what Isaiah is reflecting on in the passage that was read for you in Isaiah chapter 1. That the darkness that we see in the world often contributes to the kind of distance that exists between people and God, right? Sometimes it's that darkness that can contribute to our feelings of isolation and distance from God. It also serves as a reminder of just how close we need God to be. The darkness is real. When we read Isaiah and the message that he has for the people of Judah about 900 BC, one of the things that he's talking to them about is the results of their distant from Yahweh. He says in verse 6, from the sole of your feet to the top of your head, only wounds and welts. It reminds me of that episode from Martin when Martin gets into a fight with Tommy Hearns and Tommy Hearns, you know, beats him up. And then it's a meme now, but Martin has all these knots and welts and his face is all swollen. Well, that's how Isaiah describes Judah's condition. He says, you're in bad shape. You're in horrible shape. Verse number 5, your cities are on fire. Your fields are stripped by foreigners. Your lands are taken over by strangers. That nothing you're trying is really working. Everything is dysfunctioning and off the rails. And the question that the people had was, well, why? Right? question that maybe we have when we look around at sort of the disruptive things that are happening in the world. One of the questions we may ask is why? And Isaiah's answer is succinct. It is clear. It is focused. Verse number 4, he says, they have forsaken, or you have forsaken the Lord, right? That on the most basic level, much of the darkness that we see around us and the resulting chaos is the result of spiritual issues. It reminds me of that 2002 non-smoking campaign by the American Cancer Society. I don't know if you remember the poster. It's a girl covered in tar, smoking a cigarette. And the caption underneath reads, "If what happened on your inside happened on your outside, would you smoke?" It's like Isaiah is saying, or God is saying to the people through the prophet Isaiah, that because your inside, your internal life is so ugly, it is now manifesting itself on the outside in your social condition. That your spiritual life is dysfunctional, and now it has impacted your whole life, so that all of society is dysfunctioning. because there's something about the unseen condition that can sometimes escape people's attention. I was reading an article the other day where it talked about how epidemiologists and other public health specialists are trying to figure out ways to get people to take COVID more seriously. And one of the ideas that's on the table is trying to generate a program that will allow people to see visibly see COVID spreading from person to person in a given space or a given part of the country, because they recognize that out of sight, out of mind, that there are sometimes things that are destroying us and being greatly disruptive in our lives that we aren't addressing simply because it's not tangible, it's not something. But my friends, one of the things that hopefully 2020 has brought into sharper relief for us, clearer focus, is that darkness in the world is real, and much of that darkness is the result of people's spiritual condition, that they have simply turned their back on God. And so what does that mean? What does that look like? What does it look like for one? If one says, I'll go with you. All right, well, we've turned our back on God. Well, what then is the answer? What is the prescription? Well, one of the things that we can say isn't the prescription. Before we talk about what is, let's talk about what isn't. What isn't the prescription is religion. And Isaiah brings that out. Because God is saying to this people, you are in bad shape. And this is probably one of the most religious groups of people that you'll ever meet, right? And religion isn't helping them. If you look at verses 10 through 17, you see that they're sacrificing in the temple. You see that they're burning incense. You see that they're praying. You see that they're observing the Sabbath and other religious holidays. But yet things were still not going well for them, right? Because what they did in the temple wasn't translating to life change or even souls being nourished, right? And in fact, even though they were engaging in religious ritual, their souls were still ugly and malformed. And what does this say to us? It says to us certainly that if we can properly execute religious rituals, but then promptly execute our neighbor, something is wrong, right? It's insane. And so God says, you've turned your back on me. Well, then Judah says, well, then what do you want? Like, I don't know what you want. I'm in Bible study. I'm showing up for worship service. You know, I own, you know, a bunch of Bible apps. You know, I'm I am otherwise engaged. So what is it that you want? And God says to them, I want your heart, right? I want your heart. Well, what is the indication that God has our heart? Like, what is the indication that our heart belongs to God? Well, God lays it out for them in verse number 17. Learn to do right, seek justice, defend the oppressed, take up the cause of the fatherless, plead the case of the widow. Right? God says, I'll know that I have your heart when you care about the same things that I care about, right? And namely, what you see God expressing his care and concern for is oppressed people, right? That God is certainly an all lives matters God, but he is even more, but even in a stricter sense, he is the God of those whose lives don't seem to matter, seem to matter much to others. Right, that he is the God of the oppressed. Learn to do right, seek justice, defend the oppressed, take up the cause of the fatherless, plead the case of the widow. Look at the verbs. Defend them, take up their cause, plead their case. In other words, God says, don't come to the temple and do all the right things and then leave the temple and engage in all of the wrong things. Don't come to the temple and say all of the right things and do all of the right things and then leave the temple and not be the right kind of person. And that doesn't happen through ritual. That doesn't happen through religion, right? Because in many ways, religion disconnected, or ritual disconnected from meaningful relationship with God, it just puffs up. It just makes us proud, right? It gives us a reason to feel superior to people who aren't like us, right? That's why so many people who are excellent at practicing religion are also really good at looking their noses down on other people, right? And it's easy to get caught up in that, right? Where we look down on others who aren't from our religious tribe. Or we look down on those who don't practice as well as we do, who don't know as much Bible as we do, or pray as eloquently as we do, right? And the end result is that religious people spend more time trying to figure out who to exclude than they do trying to figure out how we can better serve. Religion is not the answer. It just leaves us feeling self-righteous and becoming increasingly self-absorbed. The word is hypocrisy. But thankfully, the opening chapters of Isaiah, chapter 1, God isn't just confronting the people with their hypocrisy. God is inviting them to do something different. Right? Even with us, 2020 didn't make us. 2020 exposed us, right? That all of that hatred, all of the vitriol, you know, all of those things were already there, right? They were there. You know, coronavirus started in 2019. You know, racial tensions and issues with the police brutality and all of that stuff, man, it was there. It's always been there. And so 2020 didn't make us. In so many ways, it's exposed us. It's exposed that even though we are still probably one of the most religious countries on the planet, right? We're upwards to 90, you know, percent plus of people consider themselves to be, you know, spiritual on some level. Even those who don't participate with an organized religion still have religious rituals and practices that they believe draw them closer to God, right? That even though we as a country are religious, religion does not help. And so what does God say? God says, listen, do something different. I want to invite you to come. Come to me. And that's the invitation that I believe that 2020 offers us. And it certainly is the invitation that the Advent reminds us of. Come, let us adore him. In Isaiah verse 18, it says, come now, let us reason together. This is God's invitation to Judah. This text, by the way, is the very first text that I ever preached, the very first sermon that I ever gave. Despite the chaos caused by the people's disobedience, God is still calling them. God is calling. He's calling them. God, all this year, has been calling us. And in verse 19, he says, if you are willing and obedient, if you're willing and obedient, then I can help lead you to a place of prosperity and plenty. And so what does he mean by calling, being willing and obedient? Well, we've already established he's not talking about temple worship. He's not talking about ritual. He's talking about caring for the oppressed. He's talking about looking after the orphan and the widow. God is saying, don't just show up to the temple. Make sure that the temple shows up in you. That all throughout 2020, God has been saying to us, even when you can't show up to a place, don't let that stop me from showing up in you. So as I close today, I want to share with you how knowing Jesus has enabled me to share light in a sometimes dark year. And it has sometimes been a dark year. First of all, just knowing him and his story. Knowing that he was born to a poor and uneducated family in a stable. That when he was a young boy, his family was forced to flee their country. And so he knows what it is to be an immigrant. He knows what it is to be unwanted. In so many ways, when you think about Jesus's life, he is the type of person that Isaiah says that we should show great care and concern for. Then all through his life, Jesus was the kind of person that Isaiah is calling us to be. Over and over again, when we read the Gospels, we see Jesus giving himself to the weak and to the poor. People that nobody wanted to be with, Jesus hung out with them. Jesus spent time with them. He touched lepers. He healed cripples. He showed dignity to prostitutes. He even loved on tax collectors. And then he turned around to his disciples and to us, and he invites us to follow his example. But more than that, in fact, the most of all, Jesus went to the cross and willingly received God's judgment for our sin. And all we have to do is receive his forgiveness by faith. For me, that is a part of the wondrous work of salvation in my own life. It is humbling that daily I come to God knowing my deficiencies, my failings, my shortcomings, knowing and recognizing that without him, I can't. But with him, in all things, I can. That his strength is made perfect in my weakness. That what God gives me, I could never earn nor deserve. And as messed up as I am, he allows me to receive what he has for me by faith as a gift. And it is having that kind of unfettered access to be able to call on him, to be able to be in his presence and to rely on him every day every moment of every hour is the reason why many of us at the end of 2020 are still standing. And not just in our right mind, but recognizing that the joy of the Lord is our strength. Religion doesn't do that. Religion doesn't provide that. Religion poisons everything, but the gospel is different. You know it. When the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, right, when it is at work in your life, it has a humbling effect. It nurtures in you compassion. It inspires you to give and to serve sacrificially. The gospel motivates us to treat other people in the same way that God has treated us. So as we reflect on the Advent and what it means in this season, today I want to ask you, as you recognize that you need more of Him, how are you planning to reflect the more of Him you already have? What does "Come, let us adore Him" mean to you and your family? God is not saying don't come to the temple. He's not saying don't worship, don't pray, don't read your Bible yet. Do those things. Worship, sing, pray. But also, I want to invite you to also share and serve and care. Who can I call? Who can I check in on? Who can I see about? How can I serve? Is there a food pantry somewhere? Is the church having something? And what can I share? How can I take some of what God has blessed me with and be a blessing to someone else? Now, I want to offer you a couple of suggestions. Every Thursday, our church is hosting a food pantry led by our bread basket and Sister Darlene Hill, Sister Phyllis Coster. They need volunteers. Maybe you have some time. Or maybe you know of other agencies or groups that have food that they can get, that they can contribute as we meet the needs of our neighbors. Also, Dr. Rosalind Wigerton is leading our food insecurity team, where they, I believe, weekly are packing up bags, of snack bags, and also groceries for children and families. We have our clothes closet. Darlene and Phyllis, and I'm just naming names, if there are others, other volunteers that work with those groups, and forgive me, I hate to start calling names, but they need volunteers to help to continue to sort clothes, move clothes, and be there to volunteer to help distribute clothes to those that have need. We have houses there on our campus that are ready, that are open, that are available, but they need some TLC. Can you volunteer some man hours or some woman hours to help paint a wall or repair a roof? Or do you have any skill as it relates to rehabbing or refurbishing a property? On December the 19th, we're doing a toy giveaway. Do you have money that you can contribute? Do you have toys that you can share? Do you have time that you can volunteer? And certainly during this time of the year, we have so many people that we know and love that are in bereavement, that are grieving. Some are stuck in nursing homes, separated from their families. Others are shut in to their into their houses. Are you available to make a phone call or to send a text? Or to write a letter, or to mail a card. But as we reflect on how much we need God close. Let's also reflect on what it means to express the closeness that we already enjoy. Whatever you do, do something. We love you. God bless.